Okay, what's going on YouTube? This is PNG Media News again, back at you with another interview. Today I have an author. He's going to be talking about the book he wrote, Chronicles of a Dirty Prison War, California Prison Politics. He's been incarcerated in the CDC since the early 70s, spent a significant amount of time in the SHU. Brother Louis Powell Jr. is going to be giving us his story. So how's it going today, Brother Powell?
Okay, so man, bro, so
I want to jump right into it. So tell us a little about where did you grow up?
I grew up in Compton, California. That's a little small city in Los Angeles County.
Okay, and back when you, and what years were you growing up there? Okay. And so you grew up there through the 70s?
Grew up there all the way up until I went to prison in 1974, but yeah, grew up there in the 60s, the 70s.
Okay, so were you around when the emergence of the Bloods and Crips and all that stuff started in Cali? Presence of the Black Panther Party, did they have any influence? Did you see them when you was growing up? So growing up in Compton, like, what was life kind of like for you? What type of things were you into growing up? Did you gangbang? Were you a Panther? Where did you fall on that spectrum?
Well, I was never involved in any street gangs. I was the victim of street gangs all the way up until the age of 16 years old. And I got assaulted maybe about three times. Even at school, I used to get sorted by street gangs inside the school campus. And so I went to a street named Stanley Perkins. And I asked him to teach me survival on the streets. And bro took me under his wing. He taught me good. He taught me so good, it was beyond his expectation. And by the age of 16 years old, I was actually accepted into the criminal underworld of Los Angeles. They entrusted me. I was basically a runner. And it was then, around the middle of 1967, that I was recruited by the Malcolm X Foundation. And that's where I really got my training and my education. I had seven teachers. And they gave me one of the best educations I could ever receive during that time period. And when I came up out of the Malcolm X Foundation, I was a trained cadre. I could put together cadres. I could put together understructure, a structure, and a superstructure. And the training I received was the training of the Mau Maus. And all the teenage males at that time had to take the Mau Mau death oath. teachers wouldn't allow us to retaliate. And so what we did, we went to our teachers and declared ourselves no longer subordinate to the Malcolm X Foundation. We're now free agents. As a result, one of the brothers went into Compton Police Station with a briefcase, a bomb briefcase, and he got blown to smithereens. No police died. The police was injured. And a few days later, a couple of youths executed two Compton police. And it went on and went on and went on. But by then, by the turn of 1969, we were...
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
By 1969, we were so well trained. In fact, it is not to ridicule the Black Panthers or anything. Black Panthers, we viewed as a civil rights organization. And we used to call them Boy Scouts playing with warfare.
Okay. So whatever became of the Malcolm X Foundation?
The Malcolm X Foundation, shortly after the two Compton police was killed, they just banished some of the dope members. Some went to Cuba, and some just went to other states within the United States. They just overnight just disappeared. And at the time, it was only 20 teenager members of the Malcolm X Foundation. It was all male. And all 20 of us, what they did, they stripped us of our names. They didn't give us no X, but they stripped us of our names and gave us numbers. I was a student number 19, the 19th of the alphabet. And there were five students to a cadre and four cadres. And that was about it. They gave us ideological, political, social, psychological education and training.
Okay. And did you all have any connection with the Black Liberation Army at all?
Later on, some of us on our own initiative, we established a connection with the Black Liberation Army. There was you had a few brothers that were based in San Diego, a cadre, and you had another cadre based in Long Beach. And so basically it was just a sharing of intelligence.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So you work with the Malcolm X organization as a teenager. So as the organization kind of disbanded, so to speak, then where did your life take? What direction did you go in? Okay, so when we left off, you were talking about the Little Devils.
Yeah. and the caliber of Randy Crisp. Randy Crisp was playing in urban guerrilla warfare. And so Crisp throughout Los Angeles, the California period, respected Randy Crisp out of Compton. Of course, I was disappointed that they became gang members. But at the time, they assured me that they're not going after innocent people. Their enemy was Piru combatants. Not to say that that was acceptable by me, because the first thing I did in 1972, I called for a peace treaty among the Crips and the Piru. Everything was going along fine until a police gang task force committed drive-by on the Piru while claiming to be Crips, and then did drive-bys on the Crips while claiming to be Piru. And so that brought an end to that peace treaty.
Okay. And speaking of Piru, do you remember or know how the Pirus got under the Blood umbrella?
The Blood umbrella was something separate from the Pirus and separate from the Bounty Hunters. But the Blood Fence embraced the Pirus and embraced the Bounty Hunters because they were enemies of the Crips.
Okay.
And so automatically, everybody assumed that Piru and Bounty Hunter was under the umbrella of Blood. But when you talk to Piru and Bounty Hunter, they would tell you that they're their own entity. And even though they fall up under that umbrella, they were not subordinated to the sense that was considered Blood sense.
Okay.
They were their own separate entity.
But over time, it kind of just joined in or something like that? Or did they always stay separate entities?
Well, like I said, the Bloods and Piruls were enemies of the Crips.
Okay.
And so, automatically, they formed a political and military alliance.
Okay, gotcha. Gotcha. Okay. All right. So, moving on. So, after that, what takes place that you end up getting locked up?
Say it again.
Okay, so after you defended the Little Devils and stuff like that, then where does your life go, or how does it occur that you end up being locked up? What happens?
Okay, I went after I defended the Little Devils.
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
I was forced to go underground. I actually was forced to go underground in late 1971, and I tried to take Sandra Pratt with me into a safe house in Palmdale, but Sandra thought that would be disrespect to the Panthers, who said that they would keep her under their umbrella protection. She was killed in November 1971, and that was a few months after the killing of George Jackson. I disbanded the Little Devils in early 1972 and went underground. When I resurfaced back in early 1974, I happened to be driving in South Central Los Angeles, and it was an evening time. It was a sister out in the street trying to weighed down traffic for somebody to stop. I made a U-turn, asked her what was the problem. She said a friend of hers was getting raped. So I had a flashlight in the glove compartment. I ran towards the back, pretending I was talking to a gang of people, and I could hear the individuals who were raping the young 14-year-old girl. I can hear them hitting the fence, jumping over the fence. I was able to pick up the little 14-year-old, put it in the car. I dropped him off, and the following year, I was on the run. I needed a safe house, and I thought about the video, Linda Kelly, who had waved me down in traffic. And so I went by her spot to see if she had a friend that I can hide out over her house for a few days. And the gang that I had kicked away, they had remembered me. And as I'm talking to Linda and leaving, because she says, hey, you need to leave, the Crystal's coming. And they were Avalon Crips, and these are the ones who were raping the little 14-year-old. They set up an ambush before I can get to the core. But I picked them sitting up the ambush. At the time, I had a German Luger on me and a 22. And so, just as they came out of ambush, I went into military mode, shot three of them. The leader of them, Buddy Gangster, was killed. As a result of the killing of Buddy Gangster, I never gave a statement. I have never given a statement, never testified in my behalf. And the jury came back after hearing the evidence with voluntary manslaughter, which sent me to state prison.
Okay. All right. So you get convicted. Now, so actually, when you get arrested, you go to Los Angeles County Jail, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, what were the dynamics of the county jail back then? Was it sectioned off by race, by gangs? How did the jail function?
No. At that time, everything was integrated in Los Angeles County Jail. So they had, downstairs, they had six-man cells. And they may put eight prisoners to a cell. That means two on the floor, another figure. They had four-man cells, but they were the six people to the floor. All the cells were integrated, white, Mexican, black. It made no difference if you were the Crip blood or whatever, BGF or Mexican mob or AB, y'all in the same cell.
Okay.
Most of the prison gang came to understand in the L.A. County Jail that was neutral.
Okay.
But my first experience in Los Angeles County Jail was in actually 1969, my first arrest as an adult. One of the white guys in the cell accused another white guy of having sex with his wife and climbing out the window. And he remembered cutting the individual on his behind with a straight razor. And so, young white who was a bitch, he was pleading with everybody that it wasn't him, and the other two individuals who reported the crime was screaming to him, turn around, pull down your pants, show him your behind that you don't got no cut on it, and it's like, what the old you know. And they took turns raping him that night right there in the cell, and the next morning they called it the suit for sale. And so I took in everything from the county jail, mostly ex-convicts ran Los Angeles County Jail. They ran it. They didn't tell me how much food to get. And so, for 6 weeks in the old county jail, they put the food cart into the tank, and the trustees is the one who feeds you. It is no guard supervision or nothing. And so for 6 weeks, every Friday, they give you two donuts. They didn't give me my two donuts. If you went to ex-con, you didn't get no donuts. Then they turn around and try to sell you your food items back to you. And so I was just under mindset. I was highly trained, and I was dealing with at least six blacks who all was ex-con and some of the biggest brothers you can see. Bodybuilders and whatnot, but I knew that the number one trustee, I was going to waste them. And so what I did, I put together two zip guns, and I went to their cell early in the morning. After chow, everybody goes to sleep. It's supposed to be open. I was the only one up. I go into the cell with a cast iron coffee pot, and I slammed it into his face a couple times while he was snoring, busted out all his teeth, nose broken. He was screaming, his traffic and another truck from the main town. And I was at the back of the tier. They came to get me. I pulled out the zip gun. It didn't register them that I had a zip gun. And I fired on one shot. They broke the cover. And a brother named Iron Man, well known in San Quentin Postal, told me he'd come into a history on an eye before the sheriff get there. So, for facts, I shot off the second zip gun. And the individual wound up telling on me. Yeah, these extra guys told on me. And they took me to the hole where they called, so I buried like 10 days. And when I got out the hole, that was the best education I got, because that single incident traveled all over LA County Jail, and some of the individuals that I could never walk in their shadow, they now embraced me. You know?
Okay.
And so, the LA County Jail was vicious.
Okay. So when you leave the county jail and go to prison, what's the first joint you land at?
I started off at the Ghana Center in Chino.
Mm-hmm.
And my first day on the yard, a cripple coached me because I was in prison for killing Buddy Gangster.
Good time to pause and get. Yeah. Okay.
It would have been a situation, a war that they couldn't win.
Mm-hmm. Okay, gotcha. So at Tracy, what were the dynamics like there? Was it like the county jail, or was it more split along racial lines and all the prison politics came into play?
California prison was totally different. We were kind of mad at the ex-convicts that was in the county jail who did not warn us. They did not tell us that when we entered California prison, the Mexicans from Southern California will become our enemies. And they were in alliance with the Aryan Brotherhood. We assumed that the Mexicans from Northern California was our enemies, who was in alliance with the Aryan Brotherhood. So when we enter prison, everything is segregated, everything. The church, the visiting room, all the work crews and stuff. There was no conversation across racial lines. There was no business across racial lines. And the war, the racist was at war. Everything was directed at blacks. Prison guards, white prison guards, armed at whites and Mexicans to carry out war against blacks, especially blacks who they considered to be Pelican or Mosul. And so when I got to Tracy, they had separate showers. They had one shower location for blacks, another shower location for all the other races. They had cells that were designated for blacks, whites, and Mexicans. Even if it was cell was open, if that cell wasn't designated for blacks and they put a black into that cell, it would jump off a race war.
Mm.
Doing searches, they only disarmed blacks. All the strategic jobs in prison was held by mostly whites. Prison guards were ditching them, so most of the prison guards were right out of the military. So they strategically positioned white prisoners to control all of California prisons' underground economy. Whites outnumbered both blacks and Mexicans put together. That was in the 1970s. Guards didn't call you, didn't give you the respect when they didn't even call you by your last name. They called you boy, nigger, monkey, buckwheat, or whatever they chose to call you. And blacks at that time had formed too many prison cliques. And before the blacks could go at it, we had to change up that phenomenon starting in Tracy. Right? And when I say change up that phenomenon, what we did, we had to weaponize the black prison population. And when I mean by weaponize, we had to bring them into uniformity. Of course, there would be blacks who would challenge it, and we would have to deal with those problems. It was, when I first arrived in Tracy, it was embarrassing for me because it was at least 13 blacks who did not come to prison as homosexuals, but they were raped and forced to male homosexual prostitution in prison. And so one of the first things one had to do was organize individuals to bring in kids to prison rapes, jail out thievery, and jail starting race riots. And that would take me nearly 3 years.
This call and your telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
To organize a force to go up against these reactionary blacks. But we were able to suppress them. And a lot of them went to the prison guards and told them, you need to get them off the general population. And so in 1977, me, a brother named Paul Reyes, and Charles Walker were removed off the general population. No write-up, and then we told the threat to prison security. And they threw us in solid
So in the midst of this, you know, as you know, trying to change the dynamic against the blacks, I mean, I often hear the early 70s portrayed as blacks were the victims, that they were always getting stabbed up, that even Crips were had their blue rags because they were getting attacked by the Mexicans so much. In your, from your assessment, were the blacks fighting back? Were they victims? What were they doing?
Okay, I can only think about the prisons that I was in at the time.
Okay.
Okay, while I was in Tracy, not a single black died at the hands of a non-black.
Okay. So what? How did you all do that? I mean, what took place?
Mm-hmm. And they respected that. They respected
Okay. Okay. So you all were able to get that respect by actually having the shed blood? Okay. Okay.
And at the same time, like I said, we had to, I hate to use this word, but it was necessary. We had to manipulate the psyche of blacks. So when we created the machine, blacks became intoxicated. I mean, individuals, warriors became intoxicated. And the machine will never catch me on my knees. Never hear me begging, please. If I catch you on your knees, that is the way you bleed. Conscious discipline is that line, training, fight all the time. George Jackson passed that test 11 years without a rest. If you want to pass that test, never get that dog on rest. Up that hill and through the tree, bring that enemy to his knees. They got the guns, we got the knives. Snatch him down and take his life. So those were some of the words in the machine. Matt Turner, he was white, cutting throat day and night. So every day, doing exercise and running, we took San Quentin prisoners and we turned San Quentin into a military boot camp.
Okay. Okay. Right. So now I heard.
No choice.
Right. Now I heard you in that chant, you mentioned George Jackson. Now, he's somewhat of a mythological as well as controversial figure. There's a lot of stories about George Jackson, so I want to clear up some facts for fiction. Was George Jackson a member or the founder of the BGF?
No, he wasn't. George wanted to be BGF. George had to basically prove himself, but he never got it.
You have 60 seconds remaining.
Never got a chance to be recruited by the BGF because he was killed in August 1971.
Okay.
We dabble again.
All right. Okay, so you left off saying George was killed before he had a chance to be recruited by the BGF.
Correct.
Okay, so
George was a prison Black Panther.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, now let me ask you this then. When exactly did the BGF start? Because I've heard several different dates from 1966 all the way to 73. When did it actually officially start and who started it?
Well, there's no name that can be connected with starting with the BGF. The BGF was a cadre of black soldiers that was in Southeast Asia. Vietnam War, and they formulated the cadre BGF, collective soldier, because of the Great War and stuff that was going on among the American GIs in Vietnam. The security officers were sending black soldiers into nests of being controlled BGF, and so they formulated a cadre to neutralize those racist demands. So when they returned back to the States, some individuals were still existing as a cadre, while others went across the United States with this way. In California, the cadre was a cadre that eventually expanded into a prison organization.
Mm-hmm.
And who brought it into prison? Some people say Bonewell. Some people say W.L. Nolan. Some people Holiday, but nobody really knows. But somebody from the street who was an ex-GI, an ex-veteran, who came to prison, created the BGF inside California prison.
Okay, okay. Right. And if you had to guess around what year, what year would you guess that happened?
As far as inside California prison?
Yeah.
Telephone number will be monitored and recorded.
I'll say about 1967. Okay. All right. And while we're on the subject of the BGF, what I want to ask you about some I want to name some names. Like, what about Qatari Golden? What role did he play? Who is he?
Well, Qatari Because Tory happened to win the war in May 1978, the war came to an end. A few months later, Tory was dead.
How did he die? So who filled his shoes after he left, after he passed? Going back a little bit, so I say, you know, you said the BGF had kind of went two different ways, the old guard and the new guard, and they went to war. Now, after Qatari won the war, did the guard, did the two different guards come back together, or they stayed separate?
Told him, I'm going to lay out the truth in LP, and And I believe that once I lay out the truth, LP would have the blacks and Tracy to subordinate themselves to Clark's new guard, and that's what happened. And so in May 1978, after Bunchy Carter, younger brother, ran the message from Clark, ran the entire picture where I can see it, and the key word was, he told me that he's under the Constitution and is opposed to the sale of Hermon. I told him that's all I need to hear. Tell Katari that I said Tracy belongs to him. At that moment, the whole board Central Committee of Generals began to ask for a political purge because they knew by losing Tracy, they lost the war.
Okay. All right. Now, another historical figure I want to ask you about, Hugo Yogi Pinnell. What was his role in all in this, just the history of the BGF? So then when that didn't happen, did that create friction between him and the BGF? All right, we'll do one more and wrap this up. Okay, so we left off talking about Yogi and Frida Durango.
Gave the BGF lot of resources. Hugo Yogi wanted those resources and pleaded Trumbo show him a way to remove those resources from the BGF, and then he can take on all those resources. But it backfired. He was successful in removing the resources from the BGF, but all those resources didn't come to Yogi's organization, Cambon, because the new left said they no longer want to have anything to do with so-called militant revolutionaries inside California prison. So, once he did that, he put himself on bad standing, and he should have known that it was about time for him to take ward footing, but he didn't do that. And so, he escaped an assault. He got there, and he never came to the yard again. So, his chief enforcer, Hakeem Dory, came out and tried to present something to the local BGF, and they killed him. And once they killed him, they came out the phone on him. Man, it's out of place. He opened the door and came to the yard again.
Okay. And that guy was killed by the BGF?
Yeah, Hakeem Dory.
Okay. Oh, okay, gotcha. Okay. So, I guess finishing off Yogi's history, so, because I understood that he had gotten so powerful that even the guards were trying to kill him at one point. They had smuggled dynamite in or something like that to try to kill him.
And that is true. Nobody could take that from him.
Okay.
But Hugo Pinell thought blacks were too spineless and too ignorant to lead themselves. And so he presented himself as the leader and wanted all the blacks to subordinate themselves to him.
Mm-hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
Okay. Last thing about him, I know this is kind of controversial, and I'm not even sure if you can speak about this, but, you know, after he, you know, was released from the SHU after all those years, you know, he was murdered, you know, whites murdered him, you know, Serrano's, I suppose, you know, ran interference, and then, of course, a riot took place, but people on the outside think that there was not enough of a response from the blacks. You know, even though Hugo wasn't black, but he ran with the blacks. What's the thought on the inside about what? What's the thought on the inside about that?
First of all, after 1984, people were dealt with all credibility with the blacks. When no one out there, he no longer came to the yard.
Okay.
You had blacks who were trying to take his life. Next of all, because we knew that he was targeted. Individuals sent him information and youngsters to put an umbrella protection around him and to neutralize the inner brotherhood threat who was ordering his death. We received that intel that Hugo Pinell had went decades without touching his loved one. And he knew that if any military move or action was taken against the inner brotherhood leader, it would snap him off the yard and put him back in solitary. So, to protect his business, he told his investors to stand down, and that was his mistake.
Oh, so he told, he declined protection from the people who were going to protect him?
Well, the only way they could protect him is by removing that inner brotherhood leader.
Oh.
Moving on him.
Okay, but he told him not to do it? Okay.
Also, what the public needs to know, that you had two whites that died in that incident too.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
I don't know why they don't know that, but when you're killing the Yogi Winston, and the two whites died on that same day, that second incident.
Okay.
In Folsom.
All right. Okay. All right. Well, okay. Well, this has been some real good history. So, just want to try to wrap it up with, how many years did you spend in the SHU?
I spent on my second term, 25 years. But all together, I got about 35 years in solitary confinement.
Wow. And you also authored the book, Chronicles of Dirty Politics. You say the title for me, I'm mixing up, but you authored that book, Chronicles of a Dirty Prison War, and you also worked on a second book, correct? Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, my second book is my autobiography. It's called War Without Justice, The Life of a Criminal. I will follow up that book with Chronicle 2, The Unfinished Story of the Dirty War in California.
Okay, all right. And
so, I should
have it out by when?
I should have the autobiography finished by summer this year.
Okay, all right. And I also understand that you've been able to get some education while you've been behind bars. Okay.
So I got
right. And then you also up, you should be up for like a parole review pretty soon, correct?
Oh, no, in 2025, I just went last year, 90, 20 years.
Damn.
I don't have insight into my life crime.
So even though you wrote a book about your life, they're saying you don't have insight into your life.
Basically, it's because they gave me a lot of confidence in the summer central. The school for so-called 25 individuals gave me information about me. They don't really get any information. That is the reason that they denied me.
Wow. That's a shame. Okay. Well, man, brother, I really thank you for your time, you know, getting this history. You know, I could have talk to you for hours. There's so much detailed history, but we're going to keep it at this, and maybe we'll have to revisit this sometime. But you all go out there and grab that book, Chronicles of a Dirty Prison War by Louis Powell Jr., and be on the lookout for Autobiography of the Compton Street Soldier, Part 1 and Part 2, coming to you all this summer. And if you want to reach Brother Powell, which I recommend you all do, you know, you look him up on a California inmate locator, send the brother some love, Louis Powell Jr. He's currently in Lancaster Prison, Lancaster, California. If you want to learn more, reach out to the brother. He's real open. He'd be glad to communicate with you all. All right, brother. So until next time, brother, I thank you again. All right. And you take care. Brother, any last words you want to say to anybody?
Yeah, I appreciate it.
All right. There you have it, YouTube. This has been another edition of Concrete and Steel Chronicles. Hope you enjoy. Until next time.